Hello and welcome to another episode of Masala History. My name is Siva and I attempt to bring interesting histories from all around the world, back them up with research and present them for easy consumption. Please continue to send in your comments and feedback so that together we can make history cool. For today's episode, I'm trying out a new format. Those of you who are consuming this episode via Facebook or Instagram TV or YouTube, you could continue to watch the video where you're hopefully seeing some relevant pictures. For those of you who would prefer the audio version, please continue to listen in from Spotify, Anchor, or wherever else you may have obtained this podcast from. And with that, let's quickly jump into today's episode. India is a land of diversity and has embraced multiple cultures, religions, faiths quite well without compromise of any identity. There are so many symbols of religious tolerance and story in this country, and today we are going to look at a very interesting and historic one, the story of a Muslim princess in a Hindu temple. But before we get into the story, I also want the listeners to understand that the attempt here is to present historic facts and evidences and the inferences that can be drawn out of them. So please do look at the story purely from the viewpoint of history and not necessarily religion. In case if I inadvertently hurt any religious sentiments, I am truly sorry upfront, and that is not the intent. For today's story, I am going to take you back to the temple town of Srirangam. We've been there in the previous podcast. Srirangam is a town that is in the south of India near Trichy. It's an island town, primarily consists of a huge temple, the second largest temple in the world, working temple in the world, about 650 acres, and has about 91 shrines where pujas are performed almost every single day through the entire year. I spent several summers in Srirangam, and one of the festivals that I always look forward to is called Vaikuntha Ekadasi. On this particular day, the Lord Ranganatha, who is a primary deity, is offered, interestingly, butter roti cooked in Mughalai fashion as prasada, or the devotional food, which is quite interesting. Also, when the Lord is made to go around the temple, it's called the Utsavam, he actually slows down in front of the Arjuna Mantapa or the Arjuna Hall, which usually is not one of the prominent parts of the temple. I was told that there is a shrine of Tulka Nachiyar within this Arjuna Mantapa, and she is the god's consort. Now, Tulka Nachiyar essentially translates into a Muslim woman. And I was always thinking, what was a Muslim woman or a Muslim lady and her shrine actually doing in an extremely orthodox Hindu temple? Who is this Tulka Nachiyar, and what is her story? In the year 1311 AD, Srirangam was under attack by Alauddin Khilji's forces. Alauddin Khilji was the Sultanate ruler of the northern India as part of the Khilji dynasty. He had his able general Malik Kafur, a ruthless army general who was raiding all south, and Malik Kafur was winning his war over the Pandyas and pretty much looting every temple that he could lay his hands on. So Malik Kafur and his forces attacked the Srirangam temple and took away all the gold and everything. The primary deity was actually protected very well by the priests and the local civilians. However, the Utsavar or the Moolavar or the smaller gold idol of Lord Vishnu couldn't be protected. Malik Kafur and his forces took the Utsavar away with them back to Delhi. Now, this was a huge letdown and a sort of a morale failure for the civilian and the pilgrim community of Srirangam. So they decided to somehow get the idol back. A bunch of youngsters from Srirangam formed a music troupe, and they went all the way up to Delhi to perform in front of the Sultan. History says that they performed so well that the Sultan was extremely happy, and he asked them, what do you need? You could take anything from within this palace and I'll be more than happy to give it to you. The music troupe said, Sultan, all we want is the idol that you took away from our temple. The Sultan said, yes, fair enough, take it. And they thought the problem was over. However, that's where the twist started. The daughter of the Sultan, Suradani is supposedly her name, had meanwhile developed a liking for this particular idol. She thought it was a doll. She would dress it, she would feed it, she would put it in bed right next to her, and she was always with it. She was practically in love with the particular doll. The music troupe realized that it was going to be literally impossible to take this idol away from her. So they in some ways treacherously took it away at night and quickly started moving south towards the southern part of India, towards Srirangam, so that the Sultan doesn't change his mind and come back and retrieve the idol from them again. However, they were in for a shock because it was not the Sultan who followed them. It was actually the princess who followed them. When they realized that the princess was following them, the musicians decided to hide the idol somewhere. The princess, not knowing this, went all the way till Srirangam. She searched for her favorite idol. She couldn't find it and eventually died at the doorstep of the Srirangam temple. Finally, the idol was brought back to Srirangam when the head priest had a vision that the god came and told him that he had actually married this young princess and he wanted her to be respected and celebrated and prayed to in the temple. So she was installed as Tulukanachiyar, or the Muslim lady or the Muslim princess, in the temple at Srirangam. That's sort of how the history goes. It's pretty powerful if you really think about it, to have a Muslim princess being worshipped in a Hindu temple several thousand years back. But let's try and uncover some of the possibilities and the historic facts behind this very popular legend. There are stories that actually claim that the Princess Suradani, or the Tulukanachiyar, is the daughter of Malik Kafur. It is quite possible because Malik Kafur was originally a Hindu and then he was forcibly converted into Islam when Alauddin Khilji's army won him over. However, he is also a eunuch, and there is absolutely no record of any family of Malik Kafur whatsoever. In fact, it is being told that Alauddin Khilji liked Malik Kafur largely because he didn't have any family and hence trusted him. So there is not a lot of chance that this princess could be Malik Kafur's daughter. The second option is that she could be the Sultan's daughter. Now, her name is Suradani, is what history says. Suradani is in some way a slang or a mispronounced term for Sultani, and hence it's heavily likely that she could be Alauddin Khilji's daughter. Now, again, there is really no proof to the fact that Alauddin Khilji had a daughter or the daughter traveled all the way south. There are absolutely no evidences, no songs or anything whatsoever to back the story up as well. The third option could be that this princess was the daughter of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Now, why is this story possibly true? It is possibly true because, first of all, she is called Tulukanachiyar, and Tuluka could also be sort of a mispronounced slang version for Tughlaq. In addition, it is also a fact that Muhammad bin Tughlaq's forces indeed invade Srirangam later, sometime after the Malik Kafur and Khilji invasion, and took away this, or tried to take away this same idol that we are talking about. However, once again, this doesn't seem possible because the word Tuluka actually existed long before Tughlaq came into the scene. In fact, Tuluka is essentially a slang version or a mispronounced version of Turkier, which actually refers to the Turks or Mohammedans essentially, who largely were of Turkish origin. Now, here is where I would love to introduce another interesting twist in this story. There is an absolute parallel version of the very same story of Tulukanachiyar in another temple in South India. For that, we are going to travel to Melkote. Melkote is again a small town in Karnataka, in modern day Karnataka, and has a fantastic temple that's sitting above a rock hill. The story of this temple is that Sri Ramanujacharya, who was the founder of the Advaita philosophy, he spent over a decade in Melkote and had a vision that the primary deity of this temple was actually in Afghanistan, in Kabul, with the king's daughter. So he traveled all the way apparently to Kabul and met King Masud III, who is essentially the great-great-grandson of Muhammad of Ghazni, the guy who lost out 17 times, if you remember the story. From here on, the story is pretty much parallel to the Srirangam story, where apparently the daughter of Masud III was in love with this particular doll. She would feed him, dress him. And when Ramanujacharya took away the doll and walked all the way to Melkot, the princess followed suit till Melkot and eventually gave up her life there. And Ramanuja decided to celebrate her love and affection for the god by installing her as a shrine to be worshipped in Melkot, which you can find even today. In Melkot, this person, this princess, is referred to as the Bivi Nachiyar, which is possibly referring to the fact that the god had taken her as a wife, so the word Bibi. It is also possible that her original name was Bivi, which was a common name in the Ghazni dynasty. Now, continuing the story, what is very interesting is that Sri Ramanujacharya, who essentially played the primary role in this particular situation in Melkot, went on to become the head priest in Srirangam temple several years later. In fact, even today, his body is preserved in the Srirangam temple after 700-800 years. And it is heavily likely that he essentially took the concept of Bivi Nachiyar and put it in Srirangam as well, where the common word for Muslims, the Tuluka, was used, and Bivi Nachiyar essentially became Tuluka Nachiyar. So interestingly, now we have two separate temples in South India, which are commonly connected only by Sri Ramanujacharya, having the concept of a Muslim princess who's given her life in devotion and love for a Hindu god. It is difficult to prove or disprove some of the stories behind this particular history. The Ramanuja history essentially happened in the mid-11th century, whereas the Tuluka Nachiyar Srirangam history happened in the mid-14th century, literally about 300 years apart. But regardless of what is story versus what is myth versus what is legend or belief, even if we assume that there is a certain bit of masala added to the actual history, the Tuluka Nachiyar incident did occur several hundred years back. That's a fact. It is a fact that a Muslim devotee, possibly someone of the high royal family, was indeed an ardent devotee of a Hindu god, and it was accepted with open arms. So in many ways, one could actually think that when there have always been moments of crisis between India's faiths, when politics is usually at crossroads, the masala that is added via myths or legends has helped everyone come together, see eye to eye, and be unified. And perhaps this is a good lesson for the current times. For those of you who are planning to visit Srirangam or Melkot, I would strongly encourage you to go visit the hall where the Nachiyar, the Muslim princess, is kept. In fact, if you're lucky and you go on a right day, you could even see the god himself dressed in a lungi, which is quote-unquote a Muslim dress, and served butter rotis in Mughalai style. That's all for today, folks. Thanks for listening and watching. If I leave you with more questions than answers today, please send your questions to me or put a comment on Instagram or Facebook. Please don't forget to subscribe the Masala History page at Facebook or Instagram, and keep your feedback coming. Take care, stay safe, and talk to you soon.